interrupt and join in.
Yeah, sure. So thank you a lot, Dan. Thank you for your invitation and for the opportunity to give this talk. So if anyone has a question, then please like cut me and ask this question directly. Don't hesitate. It's perfectly fine. So I like this kind of interaction because otherwise I'm just sitting in front of the screen and talking to the screen, which is a bit surreal. So please don't hesitate. All right, so I'm going to talk about large-scale structure and some current challenges in large-scale structure theory and data analysis. Also, I will review some recent progress in this field, which I think that was really great. Was like over the past decade, I think that we had many important results, which now put this LSS theory on very solid grounds. And this can be used right now. The large-scale structure theory has become, I think that, mature enough to be routinely used in the data analysis. So let me discuss main ingredients of this large-scale structure theory. So, yeah, so here I'm going to present some works done in collaboration mostly with Oliver Philcox, who is a PhD student at Princeton University, then Anton Chudaikin, who's a postdoc at McMaster University, and Marko Simonovic, who's a group leader at CERN, and Matias Eldariaga, professor at the Institute for Advanced Study. And also, this work was done along with many other people whom you can see on the screen. All right, so let me first give you some introduction on the effective field theory of large-scale structure. So I think that our main goal is to improve our understanding of nature from cosmological observations. And as I guess you all know, like the bulk of our understanding so far has come from the measurements of the cosmic microwave background radiation, or its fluctuations, temperature fluctuations observed from the sky. And these fluctuations are, they represent a random stochastic field, and hence it's appropriate to describe it in terms of the summary statistics, like correlation functions. The simplest one is the two-point function called the power spectrum. So D is proportional just to delta T over T squared. And this power spectrum is a function of the angular scale, or in harmonic space, the function of the multiple number. And hence the shape of this function, the shape of the spectrum, can be used to learn something about the history of the universe and its composition. And with galaxies, we have a pretty much similar picture. So we observe density, galaxies are density fluctuations. We observe them on the sky. So these density fluctuations are also stochastic in nature, and it's best to characterize them in terms of correlation functions, like the two-point function, the power spectrum of the so-called density contrast, delta rho over rho. So where rho is the background density of the universe, and delta rho is some local density fluctuation. And just like in the CMB case, it is a function of of the wave number of the 3D of a certain 3D variable. And here this point is very important, because with galaxies we get to observe also the redshift, which means that we have something like many images of the CMB. And hence, potentially, just at face value, it can allow us to extract much more information than the CMB. And essentially, the idea how we're going to analyze this data is to do the same thing as we're used to in the CMB context. So given the measurements of the CMB spectrum as a function of the angular scale or the multiple number, then we use some Boltzmann codes like class or comp to compute the theoretical prediction for this power spectrum as a function of cosmological parameters, and then compare the two, which allows us to define the regions of parameter space that are most likely to produce the observed spectrum. And with galaxies, we want to do pretty much the same thing. So we have measurements of the galaxy power spectrum by large spectroscopic surveys like BOSS or SDSS. And in principle, we want to compute some theoretical curve that describes the spectra as a function of cosmological parameters and get the optimal values of those parameters. And this program was initiated long ago. There's a famous paper by Max Tegmark, but I'm pretty sure that even before that, in the times of, say, Peebles, people were also thinking about this and they were doing essentially this kind of analysis. But unfortunately, this program was not completely carried out because I think that back then, 20 years ago, time was not ripe and there were no sufficiently powerful tools that would allow you to conduct this research direction that would allow you to compute in nonlinear power spectrum as a function of cosmological parameters. So now we're trying to revive this idea with these new better tools that come from recent advances in large-scale structure theory. So here I should also say that the main difficulty in analyzing large-scale structure in comparison to the CMB is that the large-scale structure field is nonlinear. It means the following. If we look at the CMB map, then we can see essentially some random pattern of cold and hot spots. And the cold and hot spots, they distributed more or less democratically. So there is the same number of cold and hot spots. And if we zoom in, if we look at shorter, at smaller angular scales, we're going to see pretty much the same picture on all scales. With galaxies, it's not quite true because on large scales, of course, the distribution of galaxies here, I'm showing you the snapshot from some unbody simulations. So on large scales, the distribution of galaxies looks like the CMB, so it's a Gaussian pattern. But as you zoom in, then you will start seeing a more and more complicated structure. You will see some filaments, some galaxy clusters, and so on and so forth. And those are some clearly nonlinear structures. And hence, we need to understand these nonlinearities in order to make progress. Fortunately, there are different regimes, and these nonlinearities can be at different scales tackled with different methods. So here I'm showing you the plot of the dimensionless matter power spectrum, delta capital squared, as a function of the wave number or the inverse wavelength of perturbations. So you can see that on very large scales, which means small k, the matter power spectrum is much smaller than unity, which means that we're in the regime where linear theory should do a good job. So in principle here, the distribution of matter or galaxies that we observe can be just described with the same output of the linear Boltzmann codes as we normally use for CMB. Then, well, here on this plot, I'm showing you the results of linear theory, well, prediction just extracted from Boltzmann code, versus the data that we extracted from n-body simulations, like the nonlinear matter power spectrum from an n-body simulation. So then there is a range of intermediate scales from roughly from 0.05 to 0.5 h over megaparsecs. So this is a regime where the perturbations are not super small, but they're small enough such that you can still do perturbation theory. So delta, characteristic delta is around 0.1. And this regime is very important because here still you can apply some perturbative, you can apply some analytic description. You can develop some analytical interpretation which does not rely on n-body simulation. And it means that in principle here, you can compute the matter power spectrum as a function of cosmological parameters almost as quickly as with linear theory. And these theoretical templates can be made arbitrarily precise. Then of course, you can go to very short scales, which means like high k is larger than 0.5 h over megaparsecs. But this the regime where the density, the typical density fluctuations are large. So it means that perturbation theory cannot be used anymore. And you need to do either an n-body simulation or develop some non-perturbative techniques like Hallow models or things like this. In my talk, I'm going to focus on this perturbative regime. And I'm going to show you how very accurate analytical predictions can be made here. So the simplest way of doing perturbation theory is called standard perturbation theory. And essentially here, you just assume that dark matter behaves as a pressureless perfect fluid on large scales. And also on large scales, the density fluctuations are small. So if you see some nonlinearities in the continuity equation or in the earlier equation, you can tell or expand over this nonlinearity. And in principle, if you just write the simple continuity equation, the earlier equation, here you can assume that the fluid doesn't have any pressure or sound speed, so you write just zero. And I think that the motivation to do so just comes from the picture that dark matter are just some non-interacting particles that just, you know, like fly by in the universe. And the self-interaction is very small, which means that the internal Mitri path of dark matter particles is very small. So here you can just put zero and that's it. This would be your system. And essentially standard perturbation theory solves these three equations perturbatively expanding over the linear density field. And we know that on large scales, this picture should be very precise. And then having this expansion, we essentially compute the power spectrum. So we take the expectation value of the square of the density field. And just because here we have some integral kernels in this perturbative solution, it will generate the so-called loop corrections. So yeah, essentially the perturbative solution can be found like more or less exactly to all orders to this system. And it's represented in this way as a series over this delta n's, which, and every delta n is some kernel which whose structure is totally fixed by the equation of motion times a certain number of the initial density field. So it's a convolution integral. So if you take the expectation value, if you square this delta and take the expectation value, you will get some loop corrections. So let's take a look at the first ones. So these are called the one loop contributions. So they're also called P22 and P13 because they correspond, you can draw different Feynman diagrams that correspond to them. And in principle, this procedure can be iterated. Now you can compute in a linear matter power spectrum at two loops, at three loops, and so on and so forth. But it was very like early realized that in fact, SPT fails to describe the nonlinear matter clustering. So it fails to describe the output of n-body simulations, which we believe is a kind of true numerical modeling of the system. So here you can see the matter power spectrum divided over the prediction of linear theory. And you can see that if you just compute one, if you just add one loop to your linear matter power spectrum, then it's going to overshoot. If you compute the two loop, it's going to undershoot. But it seems that just there is no scale at which these loops would improve your description. So I think that this was realized pretty early. And the reason for that is that, well, there are several reasons what went wrong. First of all, because the small parameter delta, it's of course it's small on very large scales, but it's not small in general on short scales. So it's not a small parameter, in fact, the density field on its own. Then also matter is not a perfect fluid. So because what you observe really are like the structure of the universe is not just made directly of dark matter particles. You observe some already complicated collapsed structures like halos and galaxies. And it's not clear why, for instance, the viscosity of galaxies, if you treat galaxies as a fluid, why it should be zero. And the third thing, which is kind of hinting at something goes wrong, is the fact that the loop integrals, in fact, can diverge. So as I was showing you, these loop integrals, in principle, they include the integration over all momentum range from zero to infinity. So the loop integrals run from zero to infinity. And if the matter power spectrum has some specific shape, if it doesn't decay quickly enough in the UV, then this integral diverges. And just the standard perturbation theory doesn't give you any tool to tackle this divergence, to regularize it. So people realize that in fact, the prediction of standard perturbation theory is not protected from a large UV contribution. It happened to be convergent in lambda CDM, but it's not convergent in other cosmologies. So all these problems were resolved in the framework of effective field theory of large scale structure, which essentially treats matter as an imperfect fluid. And the description of large scale structure starts at the level of the Boltzmann equation, but which is written in terms of the smoothed density field. And the smoothed density field which is convolved with a certain smoothing kernel, this smooth density field is indeed small, so you can do perturbation theory. So if you start with the Boltzmann equation and coarse grain this Boltzmann equation, then you will find out that on large scales, the large scale structure behaves like a fluid, but this fluid should have some stress energy tensor with non-zero sound speed and non-zero viscosity, and which appear due to the fact that that you still have something that in the system there appears something like a mean three path. There appears a new scale, which is in fact the scale of the displacement of a dark matter particle, like a halo over the history of the universe. And this typical displacement is about 10 megaparsecs over h. So on scales larger than 10 megaparsecs over h, you should be able to do like the fluid description, develop a fluid description. But then you still have the scale, which means that you should have a sound speed associated with this mean three path. And essentially, the effective field theory of large scale structure just tells you that you need to augment your earlier equation with the viscosity tensor, with some non-trivial stress tensor, and then parameterize, write some ansatz for the stress tensor as a serious expansion in derivatives and density fields. And the parameters that appear there, like the sound speed, the shear viscosity, bulk viscosity, will affect your observables. They are measurable parameters and they affect the dynamics of large scale structure even on large scales. So I guess that this is the main point of large scale structure. So here I guess it's important to stress that these effective parameters, the sound speed and viscosity, they're not some junk parameters. In a sense, they're true fundamental parameters of large scale structure when it's treated as a fluid. So they're as physical as the sound speed and viscosity of air, for instance, or of water. And it's very important to keep these parameters because they influence the prediction of theoretical prediction, even on large scales. And of course, you can set these parameters to zero, as people used to do in the past, and your theory will be, in some sense, more predictive because it will have less free parameters, but also it will make wrong predictions. So I think that it's very important to have these parameters and to acknowledge that they are not zero. So all in all, when you take all these things into account, you can compute the one loop matter power spectrum and find the following formula that the power spectrum will be given essentially by the linear theory at one loop order. You will have the same one loop contributions, but evaluated at a certain cutoff scale, which now controls the UV sensitivity of the theory. And then you will have to add this counter term, the sound speed, which will have two contributions. One contribution will cancel the UV dependence of this loop integrals, and the other one, it's a final contribution, will control the physical effects of the short scale clustering that backfire on large scales. So, in principle, there is this back correction effect, and you can estimate it as we estimate, for instance, viscosity in normal fluids, and it should be of order 1 megaparsec over h. And in fact, we had measured later on, this coefficient was measured in body simulation with very high significance. Well, anyway, once you put all these things together, you will see that if you compute one loop EFT or two loops EFT, you're able to describe the data at shorter scales. And for instance, with one loop, you can get here with this n-body simulation, with very small error bars, you will be able to describe the data well up to 0.1 h over megaparsec. And with two loops, you can go to even higher case. But here, when I'm showing this picture, I should say that I'm cheating a little bit because this plot already includes another ingredient, which turned out to be extremely important. It's called infrared resummation. So infrared resummation, this is the analytic description of the nonlinear evolution of the BO wiggles. So you can write down all the EFT equations as I showed you before. And those are the equations. You can see that they're still nonlinear. It's true that now these smoothed density and velocity fields, they are small, they're perturbative, so you can do perturbation theory. But it turned out that if you just naively do perturbation theory over the density, over a smooth density field, this perturbation theory will converge very slowly for the BU part of the matter power spectrum. And this can be understood from the fact that at the nonlinear level, this perturbation theory describes different effects. For instance, just at one loop, the effects that appear there are tides, displacements, and spherical collapse. So the part that is responsible for displacements happens to be large in our universe. And in the presence of the BU feature, this part, in fact, leads to some problems. It leads to slow convergence, and this can be seen from the following observation: that if you, for instance, if you compute the matter correlation function, which is the Fourier transform of the power spectrum, then you will see that the correlation function from on-body simulations, it will have a very damped BU peak as compared to the prediction of linear theory. And if you just naively evaluate the one loop EFT expression, you will find something like this. So it's true that your theory does a better job than linear theory, but still you see that the pattern, the shape of the BU peak is not perfect. And in order to account for this, we need to understand what's wrong with these large displacements. Of course, in Fourier space, this is manifest in some residual BU wiggles that are seen in the, well, residual plot bits in the EFT and the nonlinear spectrum. So let me describe in a few words what is going on here. So in principle, we'll know that the correlation function or the matter power spectrum, well, it has these BU wiggles. In Fourier space, those are just some harmonic oscillations superimposed on top of some broadband power spectrum part. In position space, we have the matter correlation function, and all these BU wiggles are collected into just one bump located at separation 100 megaparsecs over h. And it's important that this bump has some finite spread around 10 megaparsecs over h, which is, by the way, it has the same order of magnitude as the the so-called nonlinear scale. Those are typical scale. This is a typical scale of nonlinearities. So the matter power spectrum can be decomposed into two parts, the smooth part and the wiggly part. And the smooth part happens to be UV sensitive, whereas the wiggly part happens to be very infrared sensitive. So it's sensitive to modes with small wave number. So what is going on? Imagine that we have two galaxies that fall in the large scale gravitational potential. Of course, if this gravitational potential is, if the acceleration that is created by this potential is uniform, then you should see no effect, right? Because you can think of these galaxies are just, falling in the Einstein lift, and due to the equivalence principle, they should not feel this external potential at all. So uniform motion, no effect. Now imagine there is some gradient in the flow. Then we can compute the effect of this gradient on the correlation function. This is very easy to do if we just write the Fourier transform and explicitly introduce this displacement, that is, say, perpendicular to the direction of the flow. Then you can pull out this exponent from the integral and find out that, and then you have something like exponent of this delta x times the gradient acting on the correlation function, on the original linear correlation function here in this problem. And of course, if the correlation function is just smooth power law, then you can evaluate this exponent and find out that the parameter that appears here is derivative will be very small. So it will have this typical displacement over the distance between the galaxies, which is something like 100 megaparsecs. So it's a very small effect. You can perfectly take into account perturbativity. But the situation changes when you take the BU scale into account, because the presence of the BU means that you have an enhanced probability of finding two galaxies at a certain scale. Right now, these flows, if they are converging, they will move two galaxies closer to each other. If they are diverging, they will move galaxies farther from each other. So once you average over all these different flows, of course, it will lead to some degradation. It will decrease the possibility of finding the galaxies at exactly the original RBU, right? Because these galaxies have been moved. So mathematically, now we do the same procedure. We compute this. If we compute this derivative now acting on the Wigley part of the power spectrum, of the correlation function, sorry, just because it has this exponent, you will find out that the parameter that controls this shift will be proportional to the perpendicular displacement over the width of the BU peak. And this is an order one parameter, which means that this effect turns out to be non-perturbative in the variables of linear perturbation, of Eulerian perturbation theory, because we know this gradient is produced by the external gravitational potential, and the external potential is related to the delta, to the overdensity field through the Poisson equation. So this effect needs to be resummed, and there is a way to do it in a systematic manner. This approach called time-slice perturbation theory that I developed with my collaborators during my PhD. And essentially, there is a way to formulate a Lasky structure theory at the level of some partition function in a way similar to how we describe quantum theories. And this way, the diagrams that describe this suppression of the BU peak, they can be shown to correspond to the so-called daisy graphs. So you can resum these daisy graphs at linear order. They just nicely exponentiate and give you the exact function that describes this, the suppression of the BU. But most importantly, you can extend this procedure. You can resum the daisy graphs at higher orders. Like you can resum daisy graphs attached to the UV one loop contribution and so on and so forth. So there is a way to systematically extend this procedure and to compute the effect of the suppression of the BU in any observable. And once you do this, then you can find that your theory model will perfectly describe the data even from super high resolution simulations. And I think it's also important to stress that this procedure is fully calculable. This infrared resummation gives you an exact formula which doesn't have any fitting parameter, and it's the same procedure for all tracers, and you can generalize this procedure to redshift space. And this is a key thing that allows you to compare, to describe the observed data. So let me say also a few words about other important ingredients of the EFT. The first one is nonlinear bias. So just historically, when the first galaxy surveys were conducted, it was found that the power spectra of different galaxies, they have different thermalization, they have different amplitude. And it seems that on large scales, for instance, here I'm showing you the results from 2D FGRS, and you can see that this, on large scales, these two power spectrums seem to be, you know, just differ by some multiplicative constant. And then it was conjectured that the galaxy field is just a bias tracer of the density field of dark matter field. On large scales, this bias relation is linear. And then, in fact, you can do like the whole theory of, you can develop a whole theory of the formation of galaxies and show that on large scales, this linear relation must always hold as a consequence of causality. But then, of course, as you go to short scales, the relation between the observed galaxy field and dark matter density should involve more complicated operators. So it should contain, for instance, delta squared that describe the effect of spherical collapse and tidal field and so on and so forth. And in the EFT, you can write down all these operators to any order you want. And another ingredient is redshift space distortions. So redshift space distortions appear from the fact that you assign the radial position of a galaxy using its redshift, and the observed redshift is always contaminated by the peculiar velocity, which means that if you were to plot a Hubble diagram for a certain galaxy, for a collection of galaxies, right? It would always have some non-zero scatter due to this random velocity field. And the scatter is very easy to take into account just from this formula. So in fact, the power spectrum that you observe in a different coordinate system. And this coordinate system is related, it's called redshift space. And redshift space is related to real space where normally you do your calculations through the following coordinate transformation that involves the velocity field. And the velocity field, as I was showing before, it's also, it receives some nonlinear contributions, and you can do the EFT for this velocity field. And in principle, you can take this relation into account, but it's very important that because of this, you get to observe the velocity field along the line of sight. And it's important that velocity field is unbiased, unlike the density field. And the absence of bias in large scales is guaranteed by the Euclidean's principle, because the galaxy and dark matter, they feel the same acceleration. They're driven by the same acceleration in large scales. And the velocity field, as we know from linear perturbation theory, is just the time derivative of the density field. And if you just plug, if you take this coordinate transformation and you plug the linear theory expression for V, VZ is the projection on the line of sight, you will find that there will be an additional contribution that is to the power spectrum, to the power that is a function of cosmology, is proportional to this logarithmic growth factor of the growth of perturbations. So, and because of this, you get to measure this function, which is called F, and it helps you a lot to constrain things like modified gravity, for instance, or neutrino masses. So it's a very important effect. And let me say that you can distinguish roughly two different physical effects. So on large scales, if you look at a certain clump of dark matter, it's collapsing. Then the galaxies that you will observe here, like in redshift space, apparently you will see them closer to each other because they have velocities directed onto each other. So apparently, instead of this, say, round clump, you will see the squashed clump. So in redshift space distortions, you'll be able to like see in the future. So you will see this clump as if it's more collapsed than it is in reality. And this is called the squashing effect or Kaiser effect. This is like a linear redshift space distortion effect. Then at short scales, there is another important effect, which is called fingers of God. Essentially, when you look at some cluster that contains that contains two galaxies with large virialized velocities, these velocities are very large. And if you assign their position according to their redshift, then you will see this cluster very elongated along the line of sight. So this is called fingers of God. And there is a nice visualization of these effects. Well, here on the left, you can see the observed galaxy distribution redshift space. On the right, the like original galaxy distribution real space that you would see if you were able to remove these redshift space distortions. So these fingers of God is very apparent, is a very clear effect. The Kaiser effect is more like statistical here. Yeah, I tried to see it, somehow I couldn't. But statistically, it's very significant. Well, anyway, maybe last thing that I want to mention in this progress in large scale structure theory. I should mention that in the EFT, redshift space distortion, the description of redshift space distortion is kind of simple in the EFT because you just need to take the EFT velocity here and essentially just use the same formula for the coordinate transformation as before. But in principle, this redshift space distortion is a fully nonlinear effect too. And EFT provides a systematic way to systematically take this effect into account. Well, finally, the last difficulty that was like a very serious bottleneck in the past, and now it's like solved, at least to lowest order, is the fast evaluation of loop integrals. So if we take a look at the simplest loop integral that appears, which is called P22, you will see that it's a three-dimensional integral, so Q is a three-dimensional momentum, over two matter power spectra. So those are just not analytic, they're computed by a Boltzmann code. And then you need to convolve them with a certain kernel that is a complicated function of momenta. And just if you compute this integral brute force, it's going to be very slow. I guess that right now, mathematical, it would take something like a couple of minutes for this integral to be computed for a single cosmology. And of course, it's not good for MCMC, but however, there is a way to evaluate this integral using the FFT log technique. So essentially, if you represent the power spectra that appear here as a sum over some power loss, then you can evaluate over like the integral over a single power law analytically. So there are formulas derived for this reason. And this way, using this FFT log, you can replace the evaluation of this integral with a matrix multiplication, which allows you to compute this integral in much less than a second. And this was a very important breakthrough. That's why I'm kind of mentioning this. But right now, this method is not like systematically extended to two loops and also to the bispectrum. I think that's a very important task for the future too. All right, so.
Misha, can I ask a question
yes.
on that?
Yes, 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 sure.
Thanks, it's Tessa here. I've seen the FFT log expression multiple times and it's an amazing technique. No one ever gives me a clear explanation of what the imaginary power law in that power law expansion means. So on your slide there, you've got K to the new plus I yeah. eta. What's that complex bit doing?
Well, in principle, the Fourier transform is a complex transformation, right? And that's why this information generically, yeah, should involve complex powers. Just because by properties of FFT.
Struggling to picture that. So I'm sort of thinking, you know, really naively of decomposing something in a Fourier series or whatever. But the object we're talking about is real here, right?
This bilinear is real. So these coefficients are complex, CM, and these powers are also complex. So both these things are complex just because generically FFT, I mean, of course you can rewrite it, I guess, if you want, in terms of like real and imaginary parts like sine and cosine. But it's easier to operate in terms of the complex numbers.
Okay. I hadn't twigged that the C's were complex, so that's useful. Is there any more words you can drape around it? Is it like a kind of phase information? I mean, it doesn't look quite like a phase. That's why I'm confused, I guess.
Yeah, normally, I mean, yeah, it's FFT log, so it's like Fourier transform of the logarithm. Normally, we would have something like cosine of different frequencies, harmonics. Mm. But here, just because of the fact that we have to span like a very long range of scales, it's more useful to expand logs in Fourier. And if you expand the logs, then generically, you will find these powers.
Okay, all right, that provides at least some more understanding. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Can you also maybe comment yes. a bit on the FFT log application for non-lambda CDM cosmologies? Or maybe some...
Oh, you see, difficult... like this FFT is just... It's a mathematical tool. It has nothing to do with cosmology. It's true that like in lambda CDM cosmology, I guess that you're referring to the fact that this F2 kernel will not have this simple structure.
Yeah, I'm referring to the fact that the splitting on cosmology dependent and cosmology independent things that are the ones that are calculate fast now in things like FastPT or mm-hmm. other codes. I think it's not trivial when things like scale-dependent growth come into play, et cetera, or neutrinos. I know that people are working on it and it will happen, but I think there's not a complete prescription that can be generalized for any model we would like to test, for example.
Yeah, for this kind of models, the way to go is to, these departures from, say, lambda CDM, typically they're very small, right? So you need to tell or expand over them, and then you will have certain coefficients times the same structures, like these structures mm-hmm. that you'd see in lambda CDM. So at least technically, this is a way to tackle these mm-hmm. things.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
So just, yeah, conceptually, it doesn't make things much more complicated.
Sure.
So yeah, in principle, this can be done. All right. So essentially, yeah, I just reviewed all these different tools that had been developed in the course of last 10 years. And finally, well, recently we had put all these things together and we produced a code that consistently computes the shape of the galaxy, well, the whole shape of the galaxy power spectrum as a function of different cosmological parameters, including all these effects, including bias, nonlinear bias, Russian space distortions, infrared resummation, counter terms, everything. And by virtue of FTLog, this evaluation is taking something like 0.1 second. So it's like one of the fastest thing in the Boltzmann code. You can easily put it in the Boltzmann code now and do the full MCMC of the observed galaxy power spectrum data. So we had put all these things together in code called ClassPT, which you can easily interface with things like Monty Python. So we hope that this code is user friendly and easy to run. And yeah, this was the reason why we put based it on the existing class Boltzmann solver. So you can find it on my GitHub. And also recently there we put some extensive tutorial that essentially shows how to. It's based on Google Colab. It's a great platform where you can install all the necessary packages just once on the cloud, and then you will be able to run the code from the browser. And essentially, we have this notebook that shows you the whole working session, starting from, you know, computing the spectra, the nonlinear spectra, all the way down to running MCMC and obtaining cosmological constraints. So please check this out. So when we finalized this code, we tested the code on the publicly available PT challenge data. So there was a challenge initiated by Masahiro Takada and Kahiro Nishimishi. So the challenge was to deduce the cosmological parameters from some high resolution, large n-body simulation data that spans the volume of 600 gigaparsecs over H. This is 100 times bigger than the Bose volume and 10 times bigger than the volume of DESI, the upcoming survey. So the task, all this data is available online. The task was to measure the parameters that were used to generate the simulations. And here on the left, you can see the power spectra. You can see the monopole and quadrupole. So the monopole essentially is the redshift space monopole is, in essence, the galaxy density field. So it's like usual matter power spectrum. And the quadrupole is the cross correlation between the velocity and the density field. So this is exactly the observable that allows you to probe the velocity field along the line of sight. So here you can see the data, but the error bars are so small, so apparently you can't see them. But on the right panel, you can see the residual plot between the theory and the data. And for instance, the error bar on the monopole is 0.1%. So we're able to, well, feed this data with our code, and we recover through cosmology with sub-percent accuracy, like different parameters, different accuracy, but mostly it was sub-percent. And later on, we repeated this test for different halos, different HODs, and we were able to find consistent results, so which gave us some confidence that we're not doing something wrong.
Can I ask you another quick question?
Yes.
In your previous slide on the challenge thing, so
yes.
Looking at the names in the challenge, I think it was it TNS, the other model you compared against? Like, did you have two competing models, or so you had the FT of LSS and TNS, or more models?
No, here the challenge is very simple. You can analyze it using any theory you want, and if you pass, then this theory is not so bad. If some theory was not used, then it just means it should be abandoned. So only the theories that pass the challenge go after that.
The models, you mean, yeah.
Yeah, and the models, yeah. Yes. So with TNS, I mean, at some point, yeah, I mean, nobody tried to do it with TNS.
Ah, okay. Another related thing is that, I mean, I noticed that you don't mention the hexadecapole, but like Bose analysis in the past have shown that the hexadecapole, you know, it's a bit more nonlinear, but it adds information and breaks the degeneracies. So can, can you so you take it, you know, you take it to a smaller Kmax, but it helps. So can you comment a bit on that?
Yes, we also took into account the hexadecouple, but we found that it gives absolutely no new information. And we believe that this statement that it gives some new information is only like an artifact of the previous analysis. If you do like the full, the whole fit to the lambda CDM parameters, then it doesn't give any new information. So it's only the
full
result
shape fit. Okay, yes. That's interesting. Yes. Thanks. So. Thank you.
Right. Yeah, I'll comment a bit on this. We also, yeah, we can also include the hexadecouple. In FT, it is as nonlinear as any other thing. So we can do, we can include hexadecouple up to Kmax 0.2, no problem. And it gives, unfortunately, it gives no information. All right. Yeah, well, I don't know, a little bit, a few words, how we decided where to stop in this challenge. We just, okay, we did this fit on many Kmax. At some point, we found that at certain Kmax, the predictions start deviating, and then like they shift at higher Kmaxes. So we decided just to cut there. And here I'm showing you the results for, well, cosmological parameters like H0, omega matter, and the amplitude of the primordial power spectrum. Then the small error bars, like the error bars that they extracted from the whole simulation, PGN simulation volume, and the large shaded region is just where we scaled this error bar to match the Bose volume, just to show that, for instance, in PGN, we had to stop at like 0.15 or 0.2, roughly here. But if we analyze things like Bose, which have like the surveys have much smaller volume, then we're able to go to much higher Kmax at the expense of some absolutely insignificant systematical error. All right. So yeah, another test that we carried out is the field level comparison, because in principle you can evaluate the EFT at the level of the n-body snapshot. So you can take the initial linear density snapshot and evolve it forward using perturbation theory and not n-body itself, and then compare to n-body. And essentially we found that on large scales, the agreement is very good. And it means that it's not only the power spectrum that we capture, but we also can describe all other correlation functions as well with the EFT. So yeah, emboldened by all these results, we reanalyzed the Bose data on the galaxy power spectrum of red luminous galaxies, spent at, across two redshift bins, centered at 0.38 and 0.61, two patches of sky, South Galactic Cup and North Galactic Cup. So we used the one loop EFT model that included seven nuisance parameters, bias parameters, shot noise, and also some counter terms. And after like marginalizing over all these parameters, we're able to extract the posterior distributions for the usual cosmological parameters like omega matter and H naught, just directly from the shape of the spectra using a single prior on BBN, on the baryon density from the BBN measurements. And we had found essentially the following results for the remaining parameters of lambda CDM. Here I should stress that we explicitly assumed a lambda CDM model, and we're able to measure H naught and omega matter, well, with the precision which is similar to that of the Planck CMB. Well, you can see that this is because we don't have such a strong degeneracy between these two parameters in the large structure data. Then other parameters like the mass fluctuation amplitude sigma 8, the power spectrum tilt, and the amplitude of the primordial spectrum, we're able to measure with error bars something like 10 times larger than Planck. But I think it's still important that we were able to get these measurements, because those are totally independent from the CMB. And for instance, even if Planck didn't exist, still right now would have some hint on the non-zero tilt of the power spectrum. So I think it's more like a proof of principle that also we can do it now, and in the future we're going to improve the measurements of these parameters. Yeah, a few comments about this analysis. Yeah, as I said, we explicitly assumed lambda CDM everywhere. Then we also used the BBN prior. In principle, it can be removed. And then this is going to yield some new interesting results. Because if you remove the BBN prior, then you will still have the constraints on things like omega matter and H0. And in this case, you can show that H0 is purely coming, that measure, it comes purely from the shape of the matter power spectrum. It doesn't come from the BEO at all. So this allows you to measure H0 without a sound horizon. then you can extend this analysis and include the so-called post-reconstructed BIO data and sharpen the constraints on each node by 30% by doing that. Also, it's possible to go beyond Lambda CDM and consider models with dynamical dark energy and some special curvature of the universe. And in this way, you will be able to derive these stringent CMB-independent constraints on dark energy and the curvature of the universe and other things. And here I should also stress that similar results were obtained by our friends, a group led by Leonardo Senatore. And I guess that it was based essentially on the same theory model, but like all technical realization and different data decisions were totally like independent, and we obtained very similar consistent results altogether. Of course, it's now as we have this power spectrum likelihood, we can run a joint analysis with Planck and we can derive new constraints on the effective number of relativistic degrees of freedom, as well as a new, some new constraint on the sum of neutrino masses. And of course, you can analyze any model you want now. It's important to mention that, well, to say that most of the information that we're able to extract really comes from the shape of the matter power spectrum, because the shape, like certain features, like the power spectrum peak, its slope, BIO wiggles, and also this baryonic step, they allow you to measure the physical densities of baryons, dark matter, and also the power spectrum tilt. So all these features, they act like standard rulers, and you observe them projected onto the sky. So you observe them in angles, and having some theory model, having some, having assumed some model with fixed, say, omega baryons on an omega CDM, you know the size of these features, and you observe their projected angular sizes, and this way you're able to extract the distance to these features, and eventually convert it into Hubble, into the Hubble constant. So Lambda CDM, essentially, there are no, the distance is controlled exclusively by H naught, and that's it, because all other parameters are fixed by the shape. And also you can measure the amplitude is F sigma A, thanks to Rasch space distortion. The Lambda CDM F is fixed again by the shape and distance, and you get to measure sigma eight without any F. And here I should also mention that in Lambda CDM, the Al-Kapuscinski effect that is typically like studied in BIO analysis, it gives no new information on cosmological parameters, because J and H were already fixed by the shape and the distance. All right, so yeah, with these results, we were able to say something new about the Hubble tension. We were able to measure H naught well, without any input from the CMB, and our result was consistent with other measurements derived within Lambda CDM from other observations of cosmological fluctuations like WMAP or CMB lensing or DS year one, and so on and so forth. Also, another result is the like Bose CFT constraints without a sun horizon, where you get like essentially a very well, you have large error bars, but on the other hand, this result is fully independent of any systematic that might be sitting in the sun horizon measurements. And yeah, essentially, now using this tool, for instance, we can constrain models that were put forward to address the Hubble tension, the difference between this model-dependent indirect measurements of H naught within Lambda CDM and the direct measurement of H naught from SHOES. And one of such model is the early dark energy model. Well, I'm running out of time. I'll just say that, yeah, essentially early dark energy model suggests that if there is a scalar axion-like scalar field that contributed to 10% of the energy density of the universe before a combination, then this would be enough to resolve the Hubble tension and provide a good fit both to the Planck and to the SHOES data. However, like in order to fit the CMB data, you need to fine tune other cosmological parameters. And these parameters will produce a bad fit to the large structure data, both to the like lensing data and both to the Bose galaxy clustering data. And essentially using our likelihood, we're able to put the strongest constraint on the early dark energy model that rules out the region of parameter space that addresses the Hubble tension at something like 4 sigma, 3 sigma. Well, depends on the analysis. And in the future, we believe that surveys like DESI nucleate will give a lot of information if the data from them are analyzed using the EFT. And for instance, we had run a forecast for DESI nucleate with the same data cuts that we have now with the same pipeline and marginalize over all necessary nuisance parameters and so on and so forth. So we try to be as realistic as possible. And we found out that the future data analyzed with Flashcast structure, with the EFT Flashcast structure, will be able to constrain the sum of neutrino masses with the one sigma air bar equal 13 milli electron volts, which will be enough to detect the minimal neutrino masses at something like 4 sigma. And also in the future, will be like by combining Flashcast structure and CMB measurements, we'll be able to immensely increase the precision of other cosmological parameters like H0 and omega CDM. Essentially, we'll be able to nail them down to 0.1%, which will come from the fact that they will have orthogonal degeneracy orientations. And well, I guess, yeah, I'm like totally running out of time, but I'll just say a few words that the current challenges, current things that I'm working on now include the bispectrum and the covariance matrices and data compression techniques. And as I showed in the previous slide, like the bispectrum is essential. Bispectrum is a three-point function of the density field, and it is essential in order to get strong constraint on the neutrino masses. And it's more complicated than the power spectrum in many instances, but some of the things have been already done, and still there are certain challenges like the survey window function treatment, and we're currently working on these things. Another complication is the covariance matrix, because the bispectrum represents a very large data vector, and you cannot just brute force the covariance matrix with mocks for it. But fortunately, there are two alternative ways, and you can estimate the covariance matrices, and hence you can derive nice constraints on cosmological parameters with few mocks or even without them. So without them, you can compute the covariance matrix analytically, and we had redone the Bose analysis with these analytical covariance matrices. In many instances, they're much nicer than the ones based on mock catalogs. They don't contain stochastic noise, for instance. And then another technique is the what we call the subspace projection. Essentially, this is a technique, this is a tool for data compression that allows you to compress the power spectrum or the bispectrum data vector into a smaller data vector whose covariance matrix now can be estimated from something like 100 mocks. Well, here, yeah, I showed some math, but it's not very essential. I guess here maybe I'll just show this picture, which well, essentially just shows that all the information encoded in the power spectrum of Bose in 100 bins, in fact, it can be collapsed into only 12 numbers that are actually being measured and that are like they capture the sensitivity of the data to cosmological parameters. And for the bispectrum, something like 2000 triangles can all be collapsed into just 9 numbers that are well measured and that capture all the cosmological information. And essentially, this will be true also for future things like Euclid and DESI. All right, so let me summarize my talk. I think that the advance in large-scale structure theory over past 10 years now has made the EFT of large-scale structure to be mature enough to be routinely used in data analysis. So perturbation theory is very robust and precise. It makes sense theoretically, because this is the only correct theory that describes the dynamics of Flashcast structure. And also we had carried multiple tests, like at the field level, participating in the PT challenge and so on and so forth, essentially all showing that it works and it's under control. Right now, using the EFT of Flashcast structure, we can obtain cosmological parameter constraints with the precision similar or even better than Planck. And in the future, we'll be able to improve these measurements and in particular also to measure the neutrino masses at 4 and 5 sigma. And the key to these new measurements also will be the consistent analysis of the bispectrum, because the galaxy density field is very nonlinear, so it contains a lot of information in the higher order correlation functions as well. Another key aspect of this will be the development of analytic covariances and data compression techniques that will allow you to save a lot of time and make your life easier. So thank you. Thank you for your attention.